Good afternoon and welcome to the seminar on insurance, life insurance, to surrender or to continue. We've organized these two special seminars because Raj Pradhan is here. As you know, he has written, I think, what, 30? How many cover stories on insurance, Raj?
Probably
30 cover stories. Insurance is a very, very difficult subject. In fact, we at Money Life Foundation also had a tough time getting our heads around it. We didn't, actually. And when we started the foundation, we had a lot of offers from insurance companies to sponsor seminars on insurance. And we realized that that's not something we wanted to do. And obviously, now that we have Raj and he's figured it out, nobody wants to sponsor seminars on insurance. So we are really happy to have the support of ICICI Bank and Disha Financial Counseling to do this, because it's an independent, non-partisan effort where we can say what we really think about the insurance business. So coming to Raj Pradhan, he is a BE in computers from Bombay University. He's done his MBA in finance from Cleveland State University in the US. He has worked as an information technology and business consultant in India and in the US for over 15 years, including 5 years in the health insurance sector. He worked in a completely different part of insurance there. And we're really fortunate that he came back, decided to come back to India permanently. And he got very, very involved with a different aspect of insurance, and which is why just a part of his cover stories are up here. He's been working with us since June 2010, and we hope to cover a lot more about this sector and have many more interactions with him as he comes from time to time. So
welcome,
over to
everyone,
you,
for our seminar. So this topic is on life insurance and pension, because some people asked about health insurance, and we'll have that health insurance seminar next Saturday. So today is life insurance, pension, especially those who already have existing policies. And I'm sure most of you may have. Just to get an idea, is there anybody who are looking for exit from a life insurance policy, that is, they feel they're trapped and they are trying to find a solution? Oh, only a few of them. So. Good. I mean, most of them are probably happy. So, are others who don't feel trapped, they are happy with the life insurance policy and they are continuing with it? Is that so, or you don't have a life insurance policy?
Term insurance.
Okay, most of you have term insurance. So, wonderful. I mean, then. Okay, that's fine. You really don't need after retirement, so that's not a problem. What about pension policies? Anybody having pension policies from life insurers, ULIP pension, traditional pension, more people? So do you all feel that there is a need to get out of the policy, or are you happy with the pension policy? Correct. Right, absolutely. And actually, to be very honest, pension policies are very difficult to surrender because of some tax implications, which we'll talk about. And honestly, I mean, everybody at some point of time have had bought life insurance policy or a pension policy, and I'm not an exception. I was missold a policy back in 2007 when I was not reading Money Life or not even associated with Money Life. So it was as simple as a bank FD getting matured and a bank calling up and saying, okay, you know, you don't have to come to the branch and we'll send you a person to renew your FD. And I said, wow, and that's great. And sit at home and get your FD get renewed. And obviously the person didn't really come with the intention of, you know, renewing the FD. It was more to sell a policy, and either the policy offered was life insurance policy or pension. And I thought, okay, you know, 25,000 rupees worth trying out and put it in a pension policy, which actually I regretted more because, like I said, pension policies are even more difficult to surrender. So down the line, in last, I paid about 5 premiums and stopped. And the reason why I can't surrender, I will explain as we go along. So we are talking about insurance cum investment product which usually have high premium. Returns can vary. If it is a ULIP in equity market, equity doing well, you may be happy with it. So we are not saying that you have to surrender policy or it's bad, but obviously if it is in a ULIP which took away a lot of your money in charges, you would not have got that much returns as you would have got if the charges were low, you know. So you are seeing net of all the charges in a ULIP. And traditional policies, again, quite opaque, more opaque than ULIP. You don't know the charges, but obviously the agent getting 35% to 40% commission from the first year itself tells that your returns at maturity are not going to be great. I mean, we had a cover story where we said it can vary even from 2% to 7% for traditional policies. So if you're really lucky, in a very long-term policy of LIC, say of 20 years policy, endowment policy, historically have given 7%, you know, if you have stayed for those 20 years, you know, including all the bonus and final edition bonus. But again, that's history. The bonuses have come down. So and if it's a policy of say only 10 years, then you would have only got 5%. So it's really dependent on the policy term and insurance company and the product and everything. So what is the way out? We did a couple of cover stories. One we did in 2012. And we actually don't recommend just blindly surrendering because I think there's a more loss to it than, you know, making a conscious decision, trying to see, is it okay to keep on paying premium? If not, is it okay to surrender? If not, even there is a third option. I mean, the topic is continue or surrender, but there is actually a third option, which is a paid up, you know, where you actually stop paying the premium and don't surrender. You just sit on the policy without doing anything. And that is also not a bad option. I mean, we actually came out and said that, you know, don't surrender. You know, it's, you know, many media people have said, yeah, I mean, just go ahead and surrender. You know, it's a bad policy, and you know, just forget about your money and don't put, and you know, get whatever out of it and move on. But we felt there is a case to really think about all these three options with open mind, and you know, not just blindly surrendering and saying that, you know, it's bad to and go out of it. But again, the best solution is to, I mean, we at MoneyLife don't really recommend buying investment cum insurance product. And by that, I mean, don't buy ULIP, don't buy traditional. We strongly feel that the best way to insure yourself for life is, and obviously many of you have already said that you have term life insurance, then that's wonderful. Because, you know, if you have term life insurance, then you are properly covered for life insurance and you have your funds which you can use for investment purposes, where you have other better avenues like mutual funds, tax-free bonds, even bank FDs, PPF, which you can use for investment purposes. So why mix investment and insurance together when you don't get the best out of the two? Online term plans, again, we feel it's better than offline term plan. I mean, there is no real case to go for offline term plan. I mean, if you have an online term plan, you save on premium and you are much better off. So today's topic, we are actually going to focus on these things. Old ULIPs purchased before 2010, September. New ULIPs, old traditional, new traditional, and old and new pension. And this is a cover story which we did just last year. Second cover story on the, on this particular subject, which I'm sure it's much more detailed than the first one, and obviously worth reading to know we have given in detail for each of these cases. So old ULIP purchased before September 2010. Anybody having old ULIP till now? You have old ULIP, okay. So those old ULIPs obviously needed three premiums to be paid to get a surrender value. If you're not paid three premiums, have you paid three premiums?
Matured, I elected for growing.
But you paid three premiums?
No, more than three.
More than three premiums.
I paid three.
Okay, then that's great. Yeah, that's actually called cover continuance. In that the terminology what they use is called cover continuance for ULIP side. For traditional policies, the terminology is paid up. So it's just a name which is different. So yeah, if you have paid three premiums, then you are safe. But at least you have a value coming out of this policy, which means that if you try to surrender, you will get a value. And if you are on cover continuance, you can wait till the end of the policy term to get the amount. And perfectly fine with both the options. So you have the options of keep on paying premium, like sir is paid. I mean, it's a small amount, and you feel the funds are doing fine, fund value is okay, equity market is doing great, fine. Because the most of the charges were front loaded, so you know, first 2-3 years, the allocation charges were quite high, and now the charges would have come down. So fine, there is a case to be made that if you are happy with the policy, keep paying premium. What is your policy term? That also matters. I mean, if the policy term is quite in future, 25 years policy, and you feel that you only paid 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, yeah, it's a case. Maybe you're okay with the long term. You're young and maybe okay with the long term policy. Fine, but you have to understand that for all years, whether it is in cover continuance or whether you are paying the premium, there are going to be policy administration charges which are going to get deleted, deducted from the policy, and mortality charges, because the life insurance cover comes with mortality charges, and those charges are in a way equivalent to what an offline term plan would charge you. So the mortality charges are quite more than what an online term plan will, you know, give you. Online term plan is much more cheaper than offline term plan. For different reasons, they have marketed it. So here you have to understand your mortality charges are comparable to offline term plan, and they are going to get deducted. But you can remain invested in the policy. You paid three premiums or more. You can stop paying premium if you're not happy. Remain invested in that particular fund. You have options of different, you know, equity, debt, mix of equity, debt, and if your option is okay, if it is equity and equity is doing okay, you know, just remain with it, and your fund will do better. And if you feel that at some point you want to buy online term plan and you don't really want to continue this policy, you have to see what are the surrender charges, because surrender charges, again, in some cases were only there for first few years, and in some cases the policies had till end of the term, which actually didn't make any sense, because that time IRDA allowed them to have that flexibility of having non-standard surrender charges. So every company would have their own mind, and they would you know, in some cases even make you pay the surrender charges if you try to surrender even 1 year before the policy term. So they really trapped you in a way that you want to get out of the policy even a year before the policy term. Some surrender charges they will charge you as per the table, as per documented. It's just that the documentation may have been a fine print, you may not have seen it, and you may have missed it. So obviously you have to go back to your policy and see what are the surrender charges. Say you started paying 7 years back. Maybe you paid all the 7 years, or you paid only 3 years. Now you are in the seventh year of the policy, you have to check, okay, in the seventh year of the policy, if I try to surrender, what are the surrender charges? If it is zero, wonderful. So all you have to then think is my fund value good? If I have invested X amount of money, and after 7 years, if the money is Y, and is that Y decent enough returns for me? If it is decent enough returns and your surrender charges are zero, then there is a case saying that, okay, I mean, may worth you know, getting out of the policy when the funds are good, because again, the funds can go up and down depending on if it is in equity. If it is in debt fund, it may not go much negative. Maybe in a short term it can go negative, but debt funds over 1 year period should go positive, but it won't give more than 8-9%, 7-8%, 8-9 at the max in the debt fund, which is invested in corporate bonds, NCDs, and other things. So what you can do is In this example which I have taken, say I have paid 4 premiums for 25,000 each, my policy term was 10 years. So what I will try to think is, okay, if I have paid 4 premiums, means that I'm safe. But first of all, it's old ULIP, paid more than 3 premiums, so at least I don't lose out anything. What is my fund value? And what is the years I have completed in the policy? So my policy, which was purchased in year 2007, today would have completed 7-8 years. 7 years it's completed. So then I will say, okay, what is my fund value today? That I can get from the insurance company. It's in there in the account statement. You can ask for the account statement. Insurance companies have it online also. They have a user ID password. You can log into it and see what is the fund value. You can even switch your fund option if you feel that the fund option is not doing good. You can, you know, there's a case, switch it to another option. Obviously, it has, timing has to be right. I mean, I may have switched in the wrong option, maybe there, but it doesn't always help because you may be tempted to switch at a wrong time. I mean, I'm probably switched from equity to debt at a wrong time, and after I switched, the equity market started doing great. So my funds are sitting in debt fund, maybe making 7-8% return in last 2-3 years, wherein if I had kept in equity, it would have grown better. But that's again related to what your perception is about how the market is doing and you know, your risk tolerance. I mean, I felt I didn't want to take the risk. So its fund value may be this. And then I do see what are my surrender charges for the 7th year of the policy. So in my 7th year, if the surrender charges are 10,000, then I say my net payment if I try to surrender today is 1,33,000. So with that amount, I have to then figure out what is the return, which obviously it's not difficult to calculate. I mean, you can do it in Excel sheet where you can say you paid 4 premiums of 25,000, that's your outflow, and what you come as inflow in the 7th year is 1,33,000. The returns are about 6.48, which if I feel is decent, I can surrender, and there's no harm in that. But if I wait for a few more years, maybe the surrender charges go down. 8 years, the surrender charges may be going down to 5%, which 5,000, and maybe 9-10 year, it may be zero. If the surrender charges are zero, then it's even better because you don't have to then, you know, pay anything to the insurance company for any charges, you know, for surrendering especially.
What is the formula in Excel?
It's IRR formula for, you know, your column, row, you know, from first column to the last column, you know, to inflows and outflow to see IRR basically. That's IRR, rate of return. So again, it's you have to make that decision. I mean, I can only give what are the different parameters to look at. But finally, whether to continue paying the premium, going for cover continuance, or surrender. I mean, these three are the broad options you have for old ULIP. It's your call finally. With new ULIPs, what really happened? Anybody having new ULIPs purchased after 2010 September? Anybody?
Single premium.
Single premium is okay. New ULIP, regular premium. Okay. New ULIP, regular premium, better than old ULIP, definitely, because the surrender charges are standard, not as high as old ULIP surrender charges. So even if you only pay one premium and don't pay anything, you still don't lose. You know, unlike the old ULIP, where you may have lost everything by just paying one premium. In new ULIP, they made it strict for the insurance companies because of, you know, terrible mis-selling which happened in the old ULIP. IRDA did a decent job of, you know, forcing few things like surrender charges standard and that too not too high. And even if you just paid one premium and stopped everything after that, you still don't lose everything because, you know, that fund goes into discontinuance fund. So you stop paying the premiums, it goes into discontinued funds, and you're still locked for 5 years. So you don't get the money back till the 5 years lock-in is completed. But at least you get to earn 4% on that discontinuance fund. So, okay, you stop paying premiums after first year. Your funds get moved to discontinuance fund. They earn 4% return per annum for the next 4 years. And at the end of the year, you will get whatever is the fund value which is there at the end of 5 years. So your lock-in is 5 years. But if you do you still keep pay the premium for those how many premiums you have paid?
Five
premiums. So from year 2000 to 2015, you paid five premiums. So that's good. I mean, you have paid five premiums and you're at a stage where the lock-in period of 5 years is completed for the new ULIP. And after 5 years, the surrender charges are zero. So that is 2010, if you purchase, then premium of 2010, 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014. In 2015, when it completes full 5 years, you can come out of the policy with zero surrender charges. And whatever is the fund value, you get it back. The only thing is, see, if you think you want to continue, you know, I mean, there's no harm in, if it is an equity fund, equity doing well, there is no reason I'm saying that, you know, surrender. I mean, because again, one of the parameter is fund value. What is the fund value? If it is in a good fund value you have made in last 5 years, based on it being in equity at the right time, then there is a case said, okay, I mean, nothing wrong with the policy. The charges will be there. See, our premium allocation charge is not there because only if you pay the premium, then the premium allocation charge is there. But if you don't pay the premium, then only this policy admin charge is there and mortality charges. But again, there is one major difference in the new ULIP. There is no cover continuance. So in the new ULIP, you can't stop paying premium and let the policy run like a paid up. There's no option. After 5 years, if you stop paying premium, the moment you stop paying premium, they will close down the policy and give you back your fund value, which may be okay when the market is fine. But if it is somebody saying has invested in equity and equity market is, if in future, say 2 years down the line, if it is really, really down and you happen to not have money to pay the premium, unfortunately, then at that time you will be really, you know, wrong, because you're not able to pay the premium, the fund value is down, there is no cover continuance, means that your policy is getting terminated, auto surrender. They will give you back your fund value, whatever it is, take it back, which may be on a lower side. So again, it depends on how you want to play it with respect to fund value, with respect to no cover continuance, standard surrender charges are good, and zero surrender charges after 5 years, which is also good. You look at how many premiums you paid and what is the policy term.
Discontinuance fund is applicable after the 5 years?
No, discontinuance fund is applicable the moment you stop paying the premium in the lock-in period, within the lock-in period. So you paid one premium or two premiums, you stop paying the premiums, it gets moved to discontinuance fund, earning 4% per annum till the lock-in period is completed. And after lock-in period, they will give you back your fund value. Even if you want to remain invested, they don't allow you the option. There's no cover continuance. You just get it back, but you still earn some interest even on that discontinuance fund, so which is a good thing. You don't lose the money like many people lost in the old ULIP. I mean, we had people writing saying that they paid one premium in old ULIP, two premiums, and you know, banks, you know, telling a widow to put FD amount in a ULIP, paid one premium, unable to pay more than one premium because obviously whatever was the FD amount she could afford was put in the, you know, regular premium, old ULIP, obviously to get the commission for the bank or the agent who was selling. And the person, is shocked because she was told that she will get like a FD or, you know, she doesn't have to pay anything more. But it's a regular term, old ULIP. And if you stop paying after 1 year, it's like losing almost everything. Not almost, losing everything. They just, insurance company will just say, you're supposed to pay 3 premiums, you didn't. Just like a traditional policy also. If you have a traditional policy, if you pay premium, you're not going to get anything back. You know, so that is still there for a traditional policy, which will come to next. So old traditional, which I'm saying January 2014, for that, you have to look at what premium you have paid. Again, if you have not paid 3 premiums, then is the same case of old ULIP, where you paid only 1 or 2 premiums in the old traditional. Even people write to us, as recently somebody just wrote saying that he invested 33,000 rupees in a traditional policy, and that was not even one premium, it was one quarter of, you know, so it's like 33,000 rupees in one quarter is paid. So if he doesn't pay for the next 11 quarters, doesn't pay for the 3 full years, then there is no surrender value. So he's paid 33,000, he's supposed to pay for next 11 quarters to get some surrender value. If he's not able to pay, then it's 33,000 is gone. That's where the usual policy. Obviously the commission is still there. Old traditional, little bit better commission than new traditional, but still new traditional, the commission has not gone down as much, especially for long-term policies. So again, for old traditional, you have to look at how many premiums you paid, what is the policy term, and you have the 3 options. You want to continue paying premium, you want to surrender, or you want to make it paid up. All 3 are fine depending on your situation. If they feel the premium is quite low, probably my father purchased a traditional policy in my name 20 years back, say LIC policy endowment. I think the premium is quite low, only about 2,000 rupees, less than 2,000 rupees. The sum insured is low, 1 lakh. 20 premiums have been paid, 10 more years for the policy to go. For 2,000 rupees, it's not really worth thinking whether I should pay it or not, because amount is low, 20 years it's been paid, another 10 years to go, may as well pay it, because there is some bonus declared every year. There is something called final edition bonus, which you get for remaining with the policy till the end. So, actually has to be looked at in terms of how many premiums you have paid, what is the policy term, and whether you are happy with the policy or not. If the premium is low, just forget about it, keep on paying if you are close to the policy term. At least you will get some bonus. Final edition bonus also is decent enough in many policies. But if you are quite, early stage of the policy, if the policy is 30 years and only 3 years are completed, then there is a case saying that, okay, you have paid 3 premiums, policy is going to run for another 27 years. It's a traditional policy. You can expect returns of 5%, 6% per annum if you remain for the full 30 years. Best case, 7%. We have done some look at some LIC endowment policy, and if it's a long-term policy, if you stay for that long-term policy of 20 years or more, you might even get 7%. But if you're quite early in the stage, then you may think what you want to do. Surrender value is actually very low, so that is also another big problem, where the surrender value, which is guaranteed, is you are happy that you have paid 3 premiums and there is a surrender value for the policy, but what good is that if the surrender policy is really, really low? The guaranteed surrender value is like 30% of the premiums paid minus first year premium paid, so it's really, really low. Then it becomes like not worth surrendering also, because you're going to make a big loss by just surrendering. So then you have to say what is the non-guaranteed surrender policy, surrender value, special surrender value, which the insurance company will offer in many cases. So then you can say that if the non-guaranteed surrender value is, but you have to ask the insurance company, it's not declared in the policy document, they will just say that you have to contact the insurance company to find, to know what is the offer they can give, you know, based on their performance and based on their outlook about that particular product. But if the non-guaranteed surrender value is decent, again, good case to get out of the policy, because good time to go out of it, buy online term plan, invest, you know, in products which will give better returns, mutual fund, whether it is equity, debt mutual fund, tax-free bonds, PPF, bank FD. And the third option is paid up. So have a surrender value, but you don't want to surrender, you don't want to pay the premium, so you just sit policy, don't pay any premium, don't surrender, but then you have to wait till the end of the policy term. And how much money you will get for paid up, that also you can calculate. The insurance company will not tell you. You can calculate. Say you have a 10-year traditional policy of sum assured 10 lakhs and you paid 5 premiums. Okay, so you paid 5 premiums, which is half of the policy term, which is a sum assured of 10 lakhs. So then you paid up sum assured is half of it. So number of years you paid out of the number of years for the policy term. So half of it is 5 lakhs. So your paid up value is 5 lakhs plus any bonus which has been declared in those 5 years. So usually there is a bonus declared for every. Also you can get from the insurance company how much is the bonus declared. So any accrued bonus for each year up to the year you stop paying the premium plus your paid up sum assured. So in this case 5 lakhs paid up sum assured plus a bonus which could be 1 lakh, 1.5 lakhs depending on how you to get the real numbers to calculate that, which you can get. There's no difficulty in getting the bonus rate from the insurance company. So that is your paid up value, 5 lakhs plus 1.5 lakhs, say 6.5 lakhs. That 1.5 lakhs is what you will get after you finish 10 years. So you can't get that 6.5 lakhs immediately. But maybe it is a better option than surrendering, because say if the surrender value is only 1 lakh, 2 lakh, what good is if you have paid a premium itself which is of more than 2 lakhs and the surrender value is less than that, you're actually losing. Even after 5 years you're losing out, so you are in negative returns even after 5 years. So then you say, okay, instead of getting the surrender, you will get that 6.5 lakhs after waiting for another 5 years. So you can do that. You can wait for another 5 years for the policy term to get over and you will get your paid up value, which is paid up sum assured plus any accrued bonus. Only thing you will miss out is the final addition bonus and any future bonus. So the bonus stops accumulating the moment you stop paying the premium. So your future bonus is for 1, 8, 9, 10, you will not get it. Final addition bonus, which can be substantial in some cases, that you will not get it, but you will get your paid up sum assured. So again, if you are close to the policy term, you have paid 8 premiums out of 10 premiums, there is a case made to pay off the remaining 2 and try to get the final addition bonus and be happy with it. If you are very early in the policy, paid only 3 premiums out of 30 premiums, case is made to surrender it if it is a good surrender value, special surrender value especially, And if you are somewhere in middle, a paid up is still an option where you're not close from the beginning, you're not too close to the end, you're somewhere in middle and you don't want to surrender because it's a low special surrender value. So you wait till the end of the policy term and get at least better than surrender. And that's why we said that don't surrender blindly. Yeah, go ahead.
Should we inform the company?
No, you don't have to inform the company. It automatically goes to paid up status. Stop paying. Just stop paying. They will automatically, agent might tell you to, you know, keep on paying, obviously, because there is some commission involved. But if you stop paying after 3 premiums, you're okay with old traditional.
Life insurance,
life insurance is the prorated one, paid up one. Like I said, life insurance was 10 lakhs. You paid 5 premiums out of 10 premium. So your life insurance now is only 5 lakhs. Huh. So if the person dies, you will get that. The insured dies, then that 5 lakhs plus the accumulated bonus of 1.5 lakhs, that 6.5 lakhs, the family will get. Not the full 10 lakhs, but the prorated sum assured plus any accrued bonus. And the person doesn't die, then that 6.5 lakhs you will get after completing 5 years, 5 more years. Insurance company, based on their calculation, based on their profit in the policy or overall profit for the company, or it's non-guaranteed, so they will not give you it in writing how much they can offer. But if you ask for it, they will. If you're saying that you want to surrender it, obviously they will make you run a little bit to even get that value, but they will have to give you that value. If and only after looking at that value, then you can decide. You don't have to make a decision without knowing it. They won't say that surrender it and then we will tell you. No, you can ask, tell me what it is, then only I'll make a decision. They will have to give you what is the special surrender value, if at all. In some cases they may not offer also.
Rate of bonus is decided in the state policy?
Rate of bonus is also not decided. Bonus, but then it will be every year. So every year, at the end of the year, they will have a bonus. They will come out with a circular saying that for this last year, this is the annual bonus they have declared for so and so policy. Different policies, different bonus rate, and the final addition bonus can also change. So if there is an example which we had calculated some time back for LIC endowment plan, and this was with respect to the bonus 2 years back which we had calculated and the final addition bonus which was there 2 years back. But interestingly, what we saw, I'll go through the example in detail, but what we saw was that the final addition bonus of even LIC has come down. So it depends on when your policy matures. If the policy matures at a time when they reduce the final addition bonus, then you are unlucky. And you can't assume that the final addition bonus rate as of today is X amount. You can't assume that after 20 years it will be the same. And the perception is that the bonus will increase or it has increased, but we have found a bonus actually going down for annual bonus also, and even drastically for final addition bonus. So in our calculation, we found that the person got a decent final addition bonus based on the calculation we did 2 years back, and after that we had seen if the person had policy had matured 1-2 years later, he would have got only maybe 23 lakhs or something like that. So it's non-guaranteed. You have to understand that what we are talking about is here participating traditional policies. Okay, participating means they are getting a bonus, final addition bonus, which is non-guaranteed, but they will get it. There are other types of policies which are non-participating, which there is no bonus, there is no final addition bonus, but the returns are in a way fixed. And recently, a lot of insurance companies are coming out with these guaranteed products, where the trend is that they feel that people want to know the guarantee, want to know, don't want to depend on bonus. They don't want to, have unknowns. So they are upfront giving, certain calculations. This is the policy. You will get this X amount of premiums, Y amount at the end of policy term, and that's it. No bonus, nothing. but then they won't give you exact calculation how much is your return. That you have to do. And we had done calculations for quite a few of these guaranteed products, what you call as non-participating products. And the returns can vary from 4% to even 6% if you stay for the term, you know, whatever it is, 15 years or term. So if you remain for the full 15 years term, some policies can give up to 6%. I don't deny that. But I just read one review of one product, guaranteed product, Reliance Education Plan, which just came out. The calculation was like 4%. So nothing great. 4% is, very low. And why would one want to invest in a Reliance Education Plan, a traditional plan of 10 years, I think, and get 4% return per annum, which you can even get in a, you know, savings account. So you would rather invest in an online term plan. Rather, I won't say invest, I would say insurance for online term plan and invest in other products. But here, okay, the calculation, what you will see is that if the policy term is more, 25 years, your rate of return is more. So you're getting little much better, 6%, 7%, the policy term is 25 years. If the policy term was only 10 years, then the return on premium is only 4.25, 4.73. And we have done that for age of 25 and 42. So if you want to compare like to like, age 25, 10 years policy, 4.73. Age 25, 25 years policy, 7.21. Age 42, 10 years policy, 4.25. Age 42, 25 years policy, 6.14. And the reason you see the difference in the return for the same policy term is the age, because the higher the age, the lower the returns. I mean, somebody age 50, 55, 60, trying to buy a life insurance policy, you are going to get lower returns because your mortality rates are higher for that higher age, which means it's going to eat into your returns. If you are young, age 25, 25 years policy, definitely better returns because your mortality rates are lower being young. And there are examples of people buying a ULIP at an old age. You know, we had a case in insurance helpline where a person who was age 55 or 60, he had purchased a ULIP from HDFC Life, thinking it's an investment product, and after 5 years or so, the policy auto surrendered, loss of 96% of investment. So when you say loss of 96% of investment, means he got just like few hundred rupees back, and he's like, okay, I bought it as an investment product at the age of 60, you know, for my retirement. But then why did you buy a ULIP when you're knowing that, or even traditional, at the age of 60, if you're buying, your mortality rates are higher. This person had some medical condition also. So based on the medical condition, some heart issue or something, the mortality rate actually doubled. So the mortality rate doubled. Whatever he was putting every year, 50,000, 45,000 was going as just risk cover. Only 5,000 was getting invested. So you can imagine, if 95% of your investment premium is going for just risk cover, you actually bought a risk cover product, not an investment product. But he's thinking he's bought a risk investment product, and he was shown a benefit illustration. That time the benefit illustration didn't even consider the mortality charges. So the benefit illustration showed very rosy that he will, after 5 years or so, he will get so much, you know, fund. But that was actually based on a standard mortality for some young person, not customized benefit illustration for this particular person. So after five, and they actually didn't share any account statements to show the progress, what was happening, because if they had shared the account statements, he would have known after 1-2 years that, hey, something is wrong. A lot of things are just, you know, fund value is almost zero. Why is it? So company benefited by not showing the account statement, which actually you should. If you have a ULIP, you should ask for account statement. So after 5 years, policy auto surrendered, gave back few hundred rupees, and he wrote to us, insurance helpline. We contacted the insurance company, HDFC Life, saying that you showed the benefit illustration, which was not customized, which just gave a rosy picture, you'll get good investment after 5 years. And now you auto surrendered it, and 96% of the investment is gone down, and it's like a case where completely missold. Fortunately or unfortunately, he had already put in that case to Ombudsman, Delhi Ombudsman. So the insurance company wrote back to us saying that we can't say anything at this moment because the person has put a case in Delhi Ombudsman. So our insurance helpline avenue was not something they could help out because the case was already there in another forum. So we said fine, and the person actually went to the Delhi Ombudsman, and luckily the Delhi Ombudsman ruled in his favor, saying that company didn't show the proper benefit illustration, didn't share the account statements, didn't have, you know, first of all, shouldn't have sold a ULIP to a 60-year-old, you know, as an investment product, and they said return all the premiums back without any interest, but that's still decent enough. I mean, to get all the premiums, which was 5 years premium of 50,000 each, 2.5 lakhs, was a good decision. So the person wrote back to us, you know, saying that, you know, Delhi Ombudsman has given this ruling in his favor, which was great. But the insurance company didn't pay anything for 4 months, 5 months. Which was also surprising because the insurance company should abide to what the ombudsman has said, and there is nothing the insurance company can fight back. I mean, insurance ombudsman decision is binding on the insurance company. So it's not like they can take the dispute to any higher level. They have to pay. But they didn't pay for 5 months. So the person wrote to us, and we wrote back to the insurance company, and they made some excuse saying that we haven't got a copy of the ombudsman award, and we just got it or something, and we will pay it in next 15 days. So in a way, so you'll be surprised that even after the ombudsman award, the insurance companies, you know, can, you know, not pay for some time or try to, you know, avoid paying. And once we wrote back, then they obviously had to come up with some excuse, and they paid. But again, the ombudsman award, normally within 15 days the insurance company gets it. So there is no way 5 month delay can happen. And that's just the excuse they had. So here what I'm trying to explain is two things. One is you have the option of paying premium. If you feel that you want to continue with the policy, traditional policy, you can look at the bonus, how much is the bonus which is paid. Usually the LIC bonus used to be like 48 rupees per thousand sum assured. So if it is in the same range, it's okay. Final addition bonus we had to use from the historical number and come up with what the person will get at the end of policy term. So 10 lakhs plus 16 lakhs of bonus in terms of final addition bonus plus annual bonus. And in this case, it is 10 lakhs plus about 3 lakhs of bonus, 3.4 lakhs of bonus, which is annual bonus plus final addition bonus. So this again is a calculation which if you want to do, you can do and see if you are happy with it. If not, then you have the option of surrender or paid up. Any question on this particular? Participating usually is traditional policy. I mean, ULIP, there is no bonus concept or anything. ULIP is only fund value, which actually goes in type 1 ULIP, you know, which is the most popular one. the additional policies. And in ULIP, it is only the fund value which is what you'll get. Some people think they're going to get some assured in ULIP, but that's only if you are a type 2 ULIP, which is a little different. Most of the ULIP, it is only fund value.
In traditional plan, actually participating and non-participating comes in traditional only.
Yeah. ULIP, there is
so where the bonuses are added, it is participating.
Yeah, participating, traditional policy.
Yeah.
Endowment and money back.
Yeah, endowment money back is too different. Where endowment means you keep on paying premium in the traditional policy, you won't get anything back periodically. You'll only get everything at the end. The person is paying 37,000 rupees per annum for 25 years. Okay, and at the end of it, 25 years. He is getting 26,50,000. During that 25 years term, he is not getting anything back. Only at the end of it, he gets a lump sum money, which is inclusive of, you know, a sum assured of 10 lakhs plus all the accrued bonus, yearly bonus, final edition bonus. Now, if you have a money back, then what they will do is they will periodically pay you, say 20% of the sum assured every 5 years or something. So you will. If the sum assured is 10 lakhs, 20% of it, 2 lakhs, they will keep on paying every 4 years, 5 years. And the accrued bonus also, which you will get at the end of the full policy term. Yeah.
Policy at age of 56.
Okay, and the policy is in whose name?
The policy was apparently in the name of the daughters.
Yeah, okay.
And he was insured for both of them. Something like that, it is very confusing. And unfortunately, we lost him last year.
Okay.
And we were in a total fix. We didn't know what to do. Because he was insured. And on the top of that, there was something like if anything happens to him to cover that premium, some premium waiver was also sold to him.
Okay.
So now it was up to the age of the child, the maximum age limit. Huh. There was only 1 year difference between my eldest niece and that age gap. So we couldn't get any benefit. So now we are in a fix whether we should continue paying such a high premium in that money back.
But there is a return of, you said there was a waiver of premium, right?
So that is for the youngest child because there is a age cap for the child age. So it was 15 or 20 years and my eldest niece was 19 years. So
it didn't help.
So only 1 year.
1 year it helped.
One year waiver. So it doesn't help us.
And the policy
says for the child's age of 99, they will go on paying 1 lakh per year. So
it's a whole life policy, something like that.
It's called what? Whole life.
Whole life, yeah.
So now how do we calculate whether what should we do? Maybe next time I'll get the documents. But
correct.
Then we are in a fix whether go on paying or not go on paying.
So first question is, you have to first...
Or should we go to ombudsman?
You have to first actually see who was the insured. Because if the person died and he was insured, there should be some lump sum given. Okay. So yeah, but see, if it's a child plan, it is still the insured is the parent most of the case. Yeah. So there is a lump sum to be paid also apart from waiver of premium.
No, it is the child who is insured. We didn't get anything.
Child insured, then the wrong thing to do first of all, because normally a child plan, the parent should be insured because the child is actually not earning anything. Why would you insure a child? You know, that is the wrong thing to do. In child plan, it should be the parent should be insured and the beneficiary should be the child, you know, that's how the child.
Okay, and in that case, if the parent has died, then we should get something back.
Yeah, if the who's insured?
Okay, I'll get
you have to look at the policy. You have to look at the policy.
It was insured, so they did not get anything because the parent is right.
Yeah, but we have to see. I mean, I'm still hoping that the person, parent was insured because logically it should be the parent should be insured unless it is missold. So you have to find out.
If it is missold, you will help me.
Yeah, I
will. Because it's a big sum involved in both children's policy, I mean the premium.
Okay, we'll look at it. Sure.
Sir, I wanted to know. See, this is all, ULIP is all depends on that NAV.
Fund value, okay. Yeah.
So that NAV, if it go down.
Yes.
Go down the what you have paid. So whether there is something like safety net, so that at least that value will not go down the premium that you have paid.
No, there is only, the only safety net is if you value goes below one premium, then it will auto surrender and give you a few hundred rupees or few thousand rupees. That's a bad safety net where you get something in hand, if not 0 rupees. No, I'm just joking. What I'm trying to say is there is no safety net because it's a ULIP. I mean, people kind of think that ULIP traditional, you know, your traditional, you are at least assured of 10 lakhs at the end of policy term. So you're buying a traditional, you stay for that 10 years or 25 years, you're guaranteed this 10 lakhs plus you are guaranteed the bonus, which increases your coming what money you're going to get. In ULIP, which normally I'm talking about the type 1 ULIP, which is what is sold, only the fund value you have to look at. There's no sum assured concept, is only if the person dies, then you get the sum assured. The person doesn't die, then it's on maturity, you're only going to get the fund value. So the whole risk is borne by the insured. I mean, as far as how much the policy is going to get. I mean, the people try and think that maybe at the end of maturity, you'll get the sum assured. No, you're only going to get fund value.
To the extent of premium paid, there is no safety net.
There's no safety net. I mean, you say you have paid 25,000 four times. That's what I have paid, 1 lakh. So, my
anyway goes down that 1 lakh. That 1 lakh should be
no, it's not. I mean, then actually you have to then move it to the debt investment. But if it is going in debt fund, maybe you, say if the equity is coming down and if your NAV is going down, you use your switch option to move to debt. So at least your 1 lakh is there, move to debt fund, and then you sit for the next few years, you'll get at least 7-8% return on the debt fund. Mutual, it's like a mutual fund debt fund. I mean, it will give you 7-9% and it's not going to be very low also. So it's decent enough. I mean, that option is not bad. I mean, honestly, I mean, I've more biased towards debt because I mean, I return more on the debt side of mutual fund or, you know.
Always moderately does this thing. What he says, and so if the NAV goes down,
yeah, but if it is not going to, it's not going to auto surrender just because it, see what he's trying to, yeah, but 1 lakh is a decent amount, it's not going to auto surrender.
That's what I'm saying, if it goes down,
no, it's not going to auto surrender. It's not going to auto surrender. No, I'll tell you what happens. I'm talking, listen my example. I have paid 25,000 for 4 years, I or he, okay? 1 lakh is my investment. The fund value may be say 1,20,000, 1,10,000. It may have come down to 1 lakh, it may go down to 90 lakh, 90,000. Policy is not going to auto surrender. The policy will auto surrender. Will you listen to me? Will you listen to me? You have to listen to me. Policy will auto surrender if the fund value goes below one premium value. What is one premium value? 25,000. At 1 lakh, it will not auto surrender. There is enough of money to deduct mortality charge or whatever charge. If the fund value goes below 25,000, that's where. Even the example which I gave you about the person who lost 96% of the money, he paid 2.5 lakhs. When he's
the mortality charges actually goes year by year, it increases.
Okay.
Many people they don't know about this.
Yeah, that is fine. But let us not go to another subject. Let us focus on this so that everybody understands. The policy will auto surrender only if the fund value goes below one premium, not below your investment. And traditional policy is no concept of auto surrender. It's just that if you pay 3 premiums, then you are safe. At least you have surrender value. If you don't pay 3 premiums, you have no surrender value. So that's the concept of ULIP. Traditional plans, lock-in period, you can say 3 years. I mean, 3 years, after 3 years, you can surrender and get a surrender value. Or you can make it into paid up, how I explained, where you don't pay premium, don't surrender. But minimum 3 premiums you have to pay for the old traditional plans. After January 14, there is some change which I will come to after a while. Little benefit is there after January 2014.
Raj, can I have a
sure.
question, please?
Yeah.
The first thing I want to say is, I don't fight it shy to say that I'm an insurance agent.
Okay.
And I'm no spring chicken. I'm 68 years old.
Okay.
And I have been with insurance industry for the last 28 years.
Very good.
Okay. Today, whatever conversation you have had.
Yes.
Appears that it only appeals to the intelligent.
Okay.
Okay. Down the line, I have sold insurance.
Okay.
And I've given them, a value.
Okay.
A lot of insurance policies that I've sold have matured.
Okay.
Till today, not even a single one has ever said, I have got less money.
Okay.
Okay.
Let me just finish.
But what I have said.
Some specific policy which you have given. If you look at some private insurers, you may not even get that.
Okay.
So,
let's finish.
Okay. Go ahead. Sure.
The thing was, as I said, not a single person that got less money. In fact, they were grateful.
Fine. Maybe they didn't even calculate how much they got, right?
Absolutely. That was not...
I bet you very few people, even I had to struggle to do some of the calculations. So you have to really come up with these numbers after a good thought process, after good analysis.
I agree.
They are not
you.
People who are going to be able to calculate how much return they actually got.
You're right.
If you're putting in FD or tax-free bond, you know exactly how much you're getting. If you're putting in a traditional product, I bet you 99% of people don't know how much they have got. How much?
You're
they
very
are
true.
Just happy that they got more than what they invested. That's all.
It is true.
The whole
it
concept about insurance is that I want to get more something back. That is the whole concept of not buying term plan. We fully agree to that. People in India don't want to lose anything, and that's fine. They feel that if you're buying a term plan, it's an expense because what am I paying? X amount of money. What I'll get? Zero. No, I don't want to pay. Where term plan is good, whatever it is, whether it is offline term plan, online, doesn't matter. They will say term plan return of premium. Okay. I will at least whatever X amount of premiums I've paid, I'll get X back after 10 years. But the value of getting X back after 10 years is actually not calculated. They are just saying, okay, if I am alive for 10 years, I will get my premium back. Dal do. Chalo, theek hai, at least I'll get the premium back. But is that a value? Is there a real value given to the returns? How much is the calculation? Nobody knows.
Can
got
I continue?
The premium back? Fine.
Can I continue, sir?
Sure, go ahead.
It's not, my clientele is just not educated people. It is just not only educated people. How many people asked me, what are the returns? I'm saying, when you were talking to me, I said, in the last 28 years, how many people have asked me, even the educated people, how many have they asked me, what are the returns? Now, I tell you something, sir. I say, if you want returns, this insurance, whatever I'm selling, and this term insurance, the concept came only just a couple of years ago. Right?
No, term insurance has been there forever.
No.
People don't buy it, that's all.
No, I'm saying in India.
Sir, first of all, this is for people to understand.
No, in India, it came.
We are talking to a different segment, and even for the segment who's buying the term, traditional policies, they can also get educated and not buy it. But later, this is not a seminar to say who's right or who's wrong.
This is
Money Life perception, and this is our ideology that we don't believe in these products, and we will say it openly because we don't find any product which is a great returns or something which has really helped somebody make good amount of money. People have lost money in traditional policies. They are lost in ULIPs. I gave an example. Somebody paid only one premium of 33,000 for one quarter. Not a very rich man, but he has to pay another 11 installments
Correct.
To complete 3 years.
You're right.
Is the company going to give that 33,000 rupees back? No. He's lost it. Why would he have lost it in a term plan or, in a FD or any other investment product? No,
you're right.
Bought it for investment, but he's lost the whole money.
I agree with you 100% that so things have been missold. The ULIPs.
We'll come back to your, let us finish this seminar. If there is an example of you getting trapped in any policy, we will help you. But let us not debate on this topic, which there is no end. So let us complete. And if somebody has a question on particular policies or any how to get out of it or what to do, we'll help you. Go ahead.
Hi, Raj. I'll just take 1 minute to kind of rebuttal there. You know, I've worked with an insurance company, sir, and we have sold thousands of policies. I was working with the largest, one of the largest insurance company in this country. I'm actually shocked that, you know, you may be one of the agents in this country whose clientele, I don't know the number of clientele you have, whose surrender value or who are actually in positive. I can bet you for the fact that, you know, none of the agents who are selling the products, any product, you know, traditional or non-traditional, were actually beating the inflation or, you know, were even positive. You know, coincidentally, I was actually in one of the communications, investment communication center. So whatever policy you sell is actually goes through the investment cycle, the product cycle. And I can bet it on the fact that, you know, the investment product as such and the insurance product as such is made to fool the people. I mean, I'll be using these harsh words, but this is actually made to fool. I'll be more than happy to see, you know, you can blackline or, you know, redact the name of the clients which you have, but I'm not. You may be one of the thousands. You know, I mean, that percentage is absolutely negligible of the agents, you know, who are actually having a clientele who's happy with, you know, these kind of products. I mean, these are toxic products. These are of no value. I mean, that's just one little thing I wanted to say.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? I mean, yeah, go ahead.
What is your opinion about child insurance? I mean, child life, the parents pay the premium, and at the age of 18 or whatever the period is.
Again, child plan, we had done a cover story, I think there was a cover just a few slides back. It's even more toxic than a regular plan because a couple of things. One is you have waiver of premium where the parent dies, the policy continues. The waiver of premium also comes at a cost. So you have mortality charges, you have waiver of premium charges, both it. So people are buying it thinking that at the age of 18, they're going to get a good amount of corpus, whether it is a child plan traditional or child plan ULIP. Their perception or thing is that insurance company is trying to say that your child, when they need the funds at the age of 18, will have a decent money, which doesn't happen. Most of the money is taken from the mortality charges, waiver of premium, and again you're locked in to the product where you can't get out of it easily. The concept of surrender, paid up, this all comes up because you are stuck in the policy. So our concept is buy a huge term plan for good value. That's going to be decent for, you know, a parent dies. That money will be there, 50 lakhs, 1 crore, whatever, can be saved by the wife, child, in a safe product, PPF, bank, FD, tax-free bond, and generate money out of that. So it's not like you have to buy a child plan for the child. You can buy a decent size term plan and put your remaining money in products, you know, like I said, mutual fund, tax-free bonds, PPF, which are going to give you exact amount of interest which you know of and better off.
But then
people are buying single premium child insurance. I don't think there is much advantage except that the majority will be earlier. The parent dies.
Well, I mean, the concept is that the parent dies. I mean, that's how hopefully it is insured. I mean, some cases the child plan is such sold that the child is insured, which actually doesn't make sense. I mean, the child is not really having to need a insurance because he's not really earning, and I mean, there's no financial dependency on the child's death. So the parent has to be, you know, insured. The child will be the beneficiary for the money in terms of waiver of premium or getting a corpus at a specific. I mean, the only kind of restrictions it puts is that the money is given at specific, you know, time when the child grows up. So one of the things the child plan is sold saying that, okay, the money will be given at the age of 18 and it will fall in the right hand when the child is matured enough to use that money. So don't buy term plan because, you know, the money may get misused, or somebody, child is young, or, you know, the widow might, you know, lose the money. So, but then again, you have to then think about making the family financially literate, making that, buying the term plan, and instead of saying that, okay, my family is illiterate, I will only buy a child plan so that money doesn't get misused by the family. So then again, the two school of thoughts, but then logically, if the family is educated enough, you should be able to manage the corpus given on death as a term plan and use it properly for the child needs.
Yeah, but then
yeah, so that is a structured way they try to build in. You know, trying to say that
they sell it to you. That's kind of a selling point, saying that at that time you'll get this 20,000 in hand.
Right. So this is selling.
If we can, PPF.
Yeah, you can do that with PPF also. I mean, you know.
What do you actually look at with the child's plan? The negative side.
They usually target all the grandmothers to buy it for their grandchildren.
For their grandchildren.
Yeah, so that at the age of
18... Put an advertisement in the TV saying that buy it for your grandchild.
So at the age of 18, if you're not around, at least the child has enough of funds to choose their career.
So only thing is, what is the actual return they're going to get? Is the corpus going to be decent enough, I mean, for the child to get educated? You know, that is the thing. If the parent dies, then maybe, okay, there is some sum assured given and the corpus may be okay. The parent is alive till when the child is, you know, 18. Is the corpus good enough? Because the parent has not died, which is great. Parent is alive, but is the corpus there for the education? If not,
20,
then
20 and 30. What can you do with 20, 20 and 30?
What is 20, 20 and 30?
You get 20,000 at 18 and 20,000 at 20. Oh, yeah.
20,000 after 18 years is probably.
What do you do?
What is the? Yeah. Like I said, my father purchased an endowment policy for me for 1 lakh 20 years ago. But that 1 lakh after 10 years, what is the value for it? Nothing, right? But I mean, he purchased it 20 years back, thinking, okay, at least he's done something. But I'm continuing the policy. I mean, so I'm not saying that discontinue everything. I'm paying 2,000 rupees every year, 1900 to be very precise, to LIC. And I don't know whether it is right or wrong decision to pay 1900, but I thought it was not worth enough for me to think whether it is good enough to surrender or paid up. I just said money amount is small, next 10 years continue, you know.
See, what you're telling seems so logical. So all those people who are passing these policies, because they must be going through some scrutiny at the government end mechanism, so they don't understand. Like, I mean, as simple people now, when you tell simple things, we understand.
Even IRA doesn't make it mandatory for
a non-participating
plan to clearly upfront save how much is it. You open Mint today and see an analysis of Reliance Education Plan. Reliance Education Plan looks like a wow education plan for my child or whatever. They have, I mean, done the analysis. It's a non-participating plan, which means there's no dependency on bonus. You can upfront calculate. But the IRA doesn't say that you, company, make a calculation and show it upfront, you're going to get 4%.
Why not we as consumer? I'm just asking.
It requires a media company to analyze it, whether it's MoneyLife or Mint, and to say that, hey, 4% is not good, don't buy this plan.
No, because this all money goes in the government, but, not the government.
Do you think the customers of some of the agents here are educated enough to read MoneyLife and Mint? No. So they will buy it. They will be happy with 4% because they don't know what they got.
I'm not saying only educate. I'm saying why such policies come in the market. They should not be designed only.
See, the whole concept is IRD is not just protecting the consumers, but they are worried about spreading insurance. Whether it is,
but they should just spread.
It's not like they are saying that buy term plan. They are saying buy insurance. Let the insurance companies come to India and sell products, with irrespective of whether how much returns you get. Their only concern is. In some cases, okay, you know, if having some policies, you know, whether it's endowment is better than not having any insurance, because insurance concept as such is wonderful. No denying that. And some people would rather have this endowment plan and have insurance of 10 lakhs than not having insurance. Be very honest about it. Somebody doesn't believe in term plan, don't buy it. We are not saying you have to buy it. We are just a media company saying this is our perspective, buy term plan. If you are saying you are happy, in the front beginning only I said, if you are happy with the returns and if you think, I didn't say stop premium. I didn't say that this seminar is only about surrendering or paid up. I always said in all the products, if you are happy with whatever sum assured and returns you are getting, if you are able to calculate, better to have some cover of 10 lakhs than not having any term plan of 10 lakhs, right? So at least the family gets 10 lakhs plus the bonus. Otherwise, you will not get anything. So buy it. Buy something, and you know, there are market for every product, and the people will buy. There's nothing wrong with it.
Lakshmi, you mentioned there are two types of surrender value. One is guaranteed and non-guaranteed. Is this type determined a type of application or a type of surrender?
Surrender, guaranteed surrender value is always guaranteed. It's already predefined.
No. Is this type of surrender value has to be mentioned in the application, or is it determined a type of surrender?
Guaranteed is confirmed. This is what is the value given in the policy document. Non-guaranteed is non-confirmed.
So this non-guaranteed, he has a choice, a type of surrender to go for guaranteed or non-guaranteed.
Yeah, but you have to ask for it, non-guaranteed. If you don't ask for it, they will give you guaranteed and you will probably go away. But you have to say, you want a special surrender value, show me what it is, I want that. Then they will show you what, share with you the number. So new traditional plan, again, that guaranteed surrender value is little bit improved. It's they give it little bit better than the old traditional. So the table is there for guaranteed surrender value for 4th year, 5th year, 6th year, 7th year. I think after few years they had to take approval from IRDA, but it's improved. So, but it is still not as good. It is still not as good. So you still have to probably depend on non-guaranteed one to ask for it and get a better option if this is what you are. If you're stuck in a policy purchase in January 2014, which means you only paid one or two premiums at most, then how many premiums paid? Again, there is some benefit where what they have said is if the policy term is 10 years or less, then if you pay two premiums, you will have a surrender value. So at least some consolence is there that if you have purchased this policy and only paid two premiums, there is a surrender value. But if the policy term is more than 10 years, then you have to pay the three premiums, same like the old concept. So some benefit of only paying two premiums for policy term 10 years or less and better surrender value, but that may mean that your bonus may not be as good because the money has to come from somewhere. If the people are surrendering and company is going to have to pay better surrender value, it can affect the bonus. So the returns, again, it's not going to improve the returns. The new traditional policies, the returns we don't see is going to be anything better than the old policies. So if you're happy with 4, 5, 6, 7, 6%, 7 is very idealistic. So I think roughly you should assume 4, 5 and 6. That is a max you can think of. On an average, 5% max. So again, you have to look at your policy term, how many premiums you paid here. Only two premiums would have been paid. If you're quite early in the policy, you can make a decision how you want to. The child plan, if you just spoke about it, there's a cover story I've done on that. So you can read that about, you know, all the charges which go through for waiver of premium also. And very few people can even calculate how much charges will go for waiver of premium for a ULIP child plan. You know, it's difficult to understand how much mortality charges, and it's even more difficult to understand how to calculate the waiver of premium charges. So it's very difficult.
What's the date of this issue?
2011. It was done right at the time when my daughter was born. So it has a photo of me with my daughter newborn. So I remember that. It's 2011. Some I'll okay. Yep, there is a back issue tab where you can see all the, you know, back poly, and you can see this. If you are a subscriber, you can even read the cover story online with your login. And it's a tab, you know, back issue tab where you can see all the back issues, and then you can select which back issue you want to read. So insurance term investment, according to us, is not required, not really good. So who needs term life insurance? Most of us. I mean, who have dependents should really have a term plan insurance. Mostly online term plan insurance is worth the money. If you're not comfortable, offline term plan. We are not saying that you have to buy online, but at least a term plan. Huge amount of premium, I mean, difference.
Almost 60%.
LIC just came out with the online term plan, e-term, which is probably half the premium of Amulya Jeevan.
Yeah.
Why so? Good question. I mean, there is a perception that those who are buying online are from a particular segment of people who are probably health conscious, living in a proper bigger city, having access to healthcare. So maybe you are not completely healthy, but at least you are rich enough to go to hospital and not die. So then if the person doesn't die, then the insurance companies. Yeah, there is no difference. No, I mean, obviously the medical test is good to have and good to do. Nothing, I mean, which it's good for you.
Direct, go to this hospital and do it. When you are buying on online, they direct go to such a hospital and do so and so this one. You have to go and do it.
Yeah, the only thing is the premium can little bit vary. I mean, if there is some health issue, you might see a good premium of say 5,000 rupees for 50 lakhs, and offline term plan will maybe offering 12,000. So you say, wow, offline is 12,000, online is only 5,000. So I'll buy online. And if there is a medical condition or something, that 5,000 may go to 7,000, it may go to 10,000 also, depending on, you know, what is the medical conditions. And I'm not saying offline term plan won't increase. Offline term plan can also increase, but offline term plan has a little bit more leeway and it might, you know, overlook little bit small health condition. But online term plan, they will be a little bit more strict in terms of offering you the right premium. I'm not saying strict in terms of premium, strict in terms of claims. I'm saying strict in terms of premium variation if they feel that. So they will offer you a higher premium if there is a medical condition, and then you have a choice of getting the refund minus the medical test cost or agreeing to their premium offer and completing the process. Yeah.
Excuse me. Do you have any claim settlement ratio of offline term plan and online term plan?
No, IRDA doesn't give that differentiation. But strongly believe that if somebody is young, healthy, there is no gray areas in terms of, you know, policy just bought and somebody just died immediately. I mean, if these are the early claims, you know, death claims, which even offline term plan will also investigate. Any early death claim within 3 years of buying a policy, there is bound to be more thorough investigation and more chances of denial. But if
because in some online term plans, up to 50 lakhs, they are not asking for medical test.
Yeah.
Some companies, even up to 1 crore, they are not asking for medical test. And when the claim comes, at that time, they goes for everything. Means all the medical test, financial underwriting, everything they are asking for.
For offline, you're saying?
Online.
Online. For higher sum assured, they are asking, you're saying?
No. In the case of online term plan, up to 50 lakhs,
some
most
cases,
of the company,
yeah.
And some company up to 1 crore, they are
also
not asking for any medical test.
Correct, correct.
Only
correct.
Declaration will do.
Correct.
But if claim comes, at that time they will ask for all those medical reports if they are, and they will investigate everything, and even for finance also they are going to invest.
Actually, then we always say medical test is a better thing to be done. I mean, if they don't ask, then that's actually little bad, but I'm sure there is some insurance company which will be more insistent on medical even for 25 lakhs. So, I mean, you have time, you can insist that you want to do a medical.
But
and
it also depends on the age, sir. Up to age 25, nothing is asked. Then after 25 to 30, something.
But even for young age, you can ask. I mean, you can say that you are more comfortable with medical and, you know, we are willing to bear the cost if required. So,
do we have option to change online term plan?
No. You have to stop. See, that's a good thing about term plan. There is no concept about surrender or paid up or anything. You just stop paying premium and say bye-bye, you want to buy another plan. And but LIC even doesn't allow you to shift like that. You just have to buy a new LIC e-term and stop paying to the Amulya Jeevan or other thing of paying out. Yeah.
When we buy a loan, they offer us this loan term insurance.
Right.
And which is reducing balance as per your term.
Yeah.
So is it that is better or the pure term of that loan amount for that much term? What should be?
Again, this also will work. I mean, because it's against the loan. But then if you are anyway needing a term plan, you can say that. And the bank will try to sell it from their own affiliate. So the product may look good, but the charges may be high. So if you convince the bank that you want to buy a term plan to cover the loan and they agree, then that's the best part, where you anyway need a term plan, so why go for reducing, you know, just for covering the loan. You cover for loan plus your life also, you know, in terms of having a bigger cover, so it covers the loan part also in the same policy. And if it is lower charges online, if they agree, it's okay, you can buy your own term plan and give us a documentation. I think that will be a better option than buying the reducing. But if there is no option, then at least this is better than forcing to buy an endowment or ULIP. You know, at least that loan cover, reducing loan cover, which is like a term plan just of reducing sum assured, is better than buying, forcing you to buy ULIP, you know, at the same time. So pension, according to us, is the biggest trap. I mean, So nobody has a pension product here, or they have a pension product. I have that one ULIP I'm talking about is a pension ULIP. And actually, the thing people don't know, or people have not written much about, is that pension has a bigger issue for surrender. I mean, the rules are actually very strict. For life insurance, if you surrender, there's not much of an issue. But for pension product, there is a difference in the actual tax clause, which not many people know of or write of. And we think it is the biggest issue for surrendering a pension, whether it's a pension ULIP or pension traditional. The surrender is a big issue. And the actual tax laws says that if you try to surrender a pension product, then the whole fund value will get added to your income and taxable. Because there is no concept of insurance here. So there is no concept of insurance, so it's a pure investment product. And if you try to surrender it, so best thing is don't buy a pension product from life insurance. It's not worth it. I mean, what they are offering today, it's a non-guaranteed, or what they are offering is a guarantee of non-zero return. So what they are offering is they will give you more than 0% after 10 years. You know, that is their guarantee. So it won't go you below your fund value. That is guaranteed. Even if it is a ULIP pension today, it won't go below fund value. But they are not giving you the flexibility of putting everything in equity. They have their own fund value, which has a very less equity and more of debt, and they will force you to go into that fund option only, or 100% debt. 100% debt or less equity. In old ULIP, you had that flexibility of going to full equity, but not anymore. New ULIPs for pension, there is a guarantee of non-zero, but that forces you to, you know, forces them to restrict your equity exposure. But the reason not to go is this, that you can't surrender. I mean, I can't surrender because the tax law says that I will have to put all my fund value, that is whatever, 1 lakh, say 30,000 in my case, it has to be fully added to my income and taxable, which without deducting the premium. Can you imagine? So there is no concept of deduct your premiums and know only of your gains and taxable gains. No. Whole amount, as far as the tax rule is concerned, the whole corpus gets added to the income and taxable. So what do? I have put in cover continuance and waiting for 2017 to complete the 10 years. So then I can come out of it. But again, I'm still stuck, because in 2017, when the policy matures, one third I can take out tax-free, it's a pension product. Two-third has to be mandatorily go into annuity product. So again, you're locked. So pension locks you two times, locks you for the policy term, and then locks you, makes you, forces you to buy an annuity product. Odd maturity. Annuity product today will give you say 7% return on an average, which is not bad. But annuity product, I'm not saying it's bad, but it again locks you, because you can't take out from the annuity product for your life. So you are actually locked till the end of your death. So so in my case, say 1,30,000 today, in 2017 maybe 1,40,000, 1,45,000. That one third I will take out tax free. The remaining two thirds, which could be about 1 lakh, I have to buy an annuity product of 1 lakh. On that 1 lakh, I will get 7% interest every year, 7,000 till my life. And when I die, the 1 lakh will be given to my dependent or nominee. So new ULIP, the similar concept to the new ULIP, that is standard surrender charges, no cover continuance, policy will auto surrender. But the problem is this: if it auto surrenders, then what do you do? Because it will mean that you get the fund value and it is taxable. So that is the difference. So you have to worry about. If you have this, anybody has this ULIP pension after purchase after 2010, no, then you're lucky, because if you stop paying premium, then your policy will auto surrender and that thing becomes taxable. So pension traditional, again, same thing like regular pension, you have surrender value, you have bonus, you have to look at all these things, non-guaranteed, guaranteed surrender value, and if you try to surrender, then the concept is the same, where you will have to pay taxation. I mean, I think people were getting away of. I don't think people were really paying taxes because see, the whole thing of taxation. Nobody was, even if somebody was surrendering pension policies in the past, nobody really actually, honestly, I don't think people were really adding it to the income and showing it as taxes. They could get away because there was no concept of TDS. But now the concept of TDS has come for life insurance. So if the insurance cover is not enough, there'll be TDS deducted. And once the TDS is getting deducted, it will be reported on your 26AS. When it gets reported there, then it's like a notification to the tax authorities that somebody has surrendered a policy which was of low insurance cover, which means it is taxable, or somebody has surrendered a pension policy and a TDS got deducted. Yes, that's where it will get stuck, because then the tax authority knows that this policy has some issue of taxation. And if TDS is only 2% deducted, the remaining is to be paid by you. So you have to then show the income. If you're not, then the tax person will come. But till now, that thing was not there. And I think people talk about all these Bima Bachat and Bima Bachat giving wonderful returns and, you know, it's a good product. But then Bima Bachat is offering a insurance cover of only 1.25 times the premium. It doesn't qualify for tax returns. It is a taxable. The whole thing is taxable. But nobody is actually paying tax till now. Maybe now in future they will get stuck because the insurance cover is so low. I mean, the LIC, I know my managing director came out in some media saying that Bima Bachat is our evergreen policy and people love it and everything. But what about taxation? I mean, is anybody paying tax, or are you telling customers that this thing is, boss, this is a taxable product? If you buy Bima Bachat, the insurance cover is low, only 1.25 times the premium. The whole corpus is taxable, excluding you can't even deduct the premium. Same like pension. The Bima Bachat, the whole policy, as this is in research yesterday, that people are buying it, the whole premium, whole corpus is taxable and nobody knows it. And no agent will not describe, company will not describe, insurance company, about taxation rules. But taxation is very difficult in insurance and pension. You be very careful with taxation. It's not as clear-cut as mutual fund taxation or tax-free bond taxation or PPF taxation. It is very complicated if you're not clear about what you're buying and what when you're selling and, you know, how much is the corpus.
Sir,
just additional policy of 1.25 times premium, is that's all the cover is. You can't have cover of 5 times, 10 times. Now the rule is 10 times. You know, you have to have, after January 2012, 10 times cover you have to have. Otherwise, the whole thing is taxable.
But what type of is this?
It's regular, traditional.
Sir, yeah. That pension plan, including that our Prime Minister Atal Pension Plan, that there are two stages there. One is that corpus building stage, and second that on the corpus you get the pension.
Correct.
You are in that Atal Pension, that right, corpus building stage, it builds at 8%, and while giving the pension, it gives you at 7%.
Okay.
At both the places, it is taxable. Therefore, it is not at all, even here also that on your corpus, what you are built over the year, that pension that you are getting is 6% or 7%. Of the corpus, and it is again taxable.
Correct.
So I have devised that you invest in PPF. Nowadays, up to 150,000 you can invest in PPF.
Right.
And having built the PPF, that PPF is that withdrawal is tax free.
Yeah.
Interest is also tax free.
Right.
And you can get ATC benefit in over that.
Right.
And that is the only pension that you can have it, and that withdrawal facility is available from 7th year.
Right.
That means if you cannot build your
right.
This one, if you are say aged about 52, 53 and you want to have pension starting from 60,
right.
That you start PPF right now,
yeah.
And start withdrawing from 7th year
onward.
And you
can do it for yourself and your spouse, both. I mean, even if the wife is not working, you can still do it.
Compared with pensions, what is
Why not?
Once a year you can withdraw the withdrawal. I mean, you put it in the bank.
I would say don't even withdraw for 15 years. Why withdraw? I mean,
once
why withdraw?
Once a year you withdraw. The withdrawal you put it in the
my
bank.
My PPF is running for last 15 years. I extended twice, one or two times.
For PPF, there are rules for withdrawals.
What is the withdrawal? Don't withdraw for 15
once,
years.
Once in a year you can withdraw, sir. That you use it over the year. Keep
but
it in the bank.
My concept is don't even withdraw. Let it run for 15 years. If you are young, 40 years old, I mean, you can devise your own pension. It's not nothing like you have to buy pension from life insurance. You can have your combination of whichever way you want for pension. It's the whole in mind, in your mind, how you want to develop your pension product. So, post January, again, the same concept, little bit better surrender value. Bonus may not be as good. Minimum two premiums to be paid for policy term less than 10 years and three premiums for more than that. Buyers beware. I mean, what we are trying to say is that it is mis-selling is not happening just for selling, but even for surrender. I mean, recently also people are calling in the name of IRDA, calling in the name of insurance company, saying that your policy is doing bad. Your policy is bad. Just surrender your ULIP. Just give it up. Because all they are wanting, interested, is that they want you to surrender the policy and buy a new policy. Because the whole concept is they want to get a new commission by buying a new product. So why surrender it if your ULIP is doing okay, fund value is okay? There's no reason to surrender. If there are surrender charges, then don't even surrender. Wait for the surrender charges to go down to zero. So don't do it. Don't surrender. If you already bought a policy, think about it, all the three options. Keep on paying premium, surrender, or paid up cover continuance. Don't fall for these cold calls for buying a policy or for surrender. I mean, these are all purely, you know, they get information now from anywhere. You know, you have a policy with some company, they steal the database from that company, use that, they know your name, they know your phone number, annual income. So you feel that there is some educated person who has, you know, and some people even think that they're calling from IRDA and they're trying to really help you, you know, to come out of the policy or trying to help you. But these are all, you know, just to, you know, make you fool. So don't fall for that. Buying insurance, fill up the form yourself. Advisors can do mistake or even fudge. Because we even saw some cases where the health conditions were not mentioned, and the health condition was not mentioned, and the claim was rejected. So, I mean, whose mistake it was, I don't know. I mean, the person who buys the policy should also make sure that they get a copy of the proposal after the policy is purchased. Copy of the proposal form, because they can keep it as a record saying that this is what you declared at the time of buying policy for health conditions. Don't have the copy of the proposal, family doesn't have a copy of proposal, then the insurance company might say that, well, the proposals mention so and so or doesn't mention so and so. Person is dead, the family doesn't know. So if the copy of proposal is there, received from the insurance company, not just what you filled up, that photocopy you can keep it, but something which is given back by the insurance company. And if the insurance company is not giving each thing, you should ask it, because I know some insurance companies don't do that. They don't even give you the copy of the proposal, but many do. And if you don't get it, then that actually is a bad thing. You should have a copy of your proposal, what you have submitted and what they have got as your proposal, because that is your only way for family to know that, yes, this is what my husband or whoever declared in the proposal form, of family history or medical history or what medicines they are undertaking, everything. If that document is a crucial piece, you know, as crucial as having the medical test reports. Okay, medical test reports are important, but same thing to have for. And if you're buying online term plan, then again, there's no agent involved, so you are filling up yourself. But get a copy, you know, after the policy is purchased. So legal redressal, you have.
Then this proposal form we have at a later date.
Yeah, you can. I mean, you can still ask. I mean,
nowadays most of the insurer, along with the policy, they send the proposal form. They themselves take Xerox and send it.
But I saw one company giving a proposal form in a very small print, which you don't even read. You can't even easily read. So, what is the use if you can't read your own proposal form, right? So, I think IRDA has made it mandatory that the font has to be some, you know, proper size, and so otherwise people can't even read what they have, you know, submitted. So you have grievance options, redressal options. Ombudsman has worked.
I have not heard of that IRDA grievance cell, sir.
Yeah, but because it doesn't work, that's why.
They are, I never heard of.
They are a post office. They just say.
insurance company. That's all they will do. They will, you go to the insurance company, they will reject it. You go to IRDA, IRDA will say, insurance company, look at it. That's all they do. They really don't do anything unless there is some heavy pressure on them, or when somebody is really, you know, complaining, or somebody like we complained for few cases and they took notice. So in most cases, it has not worked. Ombudsman has worked, consumer court has worked, but IRDA grievances. All right.
Ombudsman work very well.
I mean, they have a system of online logging of complaint also. IRDA has. IGMS for online logging, so you can log a complaint also, you can track it also, but it is good to do because it builds your history that you approached IRDA with a proper tracking number, IRDA received a complaint, you have to have that tracking number, that builds your history, right? Even with the insurance company, when you put file a grievance, get a complaint number or something which will help you, so you can know that you have a complaint number with insurance company, you have a complaint number with IRDA. It builds your case, showing that you did your best to, you know, complain at different levels before going to a next level.
But as far as the ombudsman is concerned, that cap is there of 20 lakhs. There is no use now because everybody is having the policy of 50 lakhs and 1 crore.
Well, I mean, honestly, I mean, for medical insurance, it does help. And for life insurance also, I think 20 lakhs, you may be right. I mean, I... Actually,
not possible, sir. Nowadays, 90% people.
I actually met the ombudsman. I actually did an interview with the ombudsman 2 days back, and he said that there was somebody who had multiple policies. So, the total policy was over 20 lakhs. But if you look at each policy, maybe he had endowment or something. It was less than 20 lakhs for each policy. So he said, why the person can. He took up the case because he said that person can file a complaint for one policy at one day, another policy on another, third policy on third day. So nothing stopping the person from split because they already had different policy. He could make a complaint at different times for different policy if there is a case. So he said, why not? I mean, he even took the case without having to person to do all this kind of split. But so there are ways even ombudsman will help you.
But somebody should go because at least that 5 crores they have to make. Because nowadays the people are buying, even ordinary person is buying a life insurance worth 50 lakhs to 1 crore.
Yeah, and that is going to be one policy, you're right. I mean, unless they split it up. So, it's a good point, very good point about ombudsman having to go for a bigger amount rather than just 20 lakhs. Yeah, consumer code is there. I mean, that also, in fact, consumer code option is also not a bad option.
No,
I mean,
but thing is that ombudsman is clearly meant for that. This one, he has got full knowledge of the working of insurance in consumer code. What happens that we have to educate them. These are the things which you have to look upon and investigate.
And ombudsman option is good because there is no cost involved. I mean, you can fight your case alone without any, you know, lawyer or anything, you just represent yourself. The insurance company will have their own representative, and in most cases, if your case is strong, I mean, at least the Mumbai ombudsman we have seen, I mean, he's gone out of his way to, you know, help the consumers and even clear the backlog of, you know, complaints. So let's hope that continues, you know.
But our fight should continue.
Yeah.
To
okay.
Increase
sure. Sure. Right. Go ahead.
IRDA grievance, I had a good experience. Even on phone, they have a phone line.
Yeah.
And they record on phone. All your call is recorded.
Okay.
You are giving a tracking number.
Okay. What
and
happened?
In 2
next?
Months, and one, I had to go to Reliance, which was a missold.
Okay.
So I just wrote one handwritten application, which was again Xerox scanned, given me as return stamp and all that. Acknowledgement.
Okay.
Within 2 months, I got my value, little more because the NAV was more. So I got.
So did IRDA help or directly the insurance?
No, both IRDA helped.
Okay.
Only thing what they didn't help is I wanted to.
So they reported.
I wanted to fix
to
the agent also, so that didn't happen. Means I wanted his agency whatever the license to be cancelled or
something.
That doesn't
work, I mean, mostly.
But I got my money back only on the phone call of the IRDA grievance.
Yeah, they have a system of phone call and internet logging, but the whole point is all they do is put the complaint back to the insurance company. But there is no pressure to, you know, on the insurance company to, if there is a clear cut case, like in your case, hopefully it was some major mishandling or some major problem, and insurance company, I mean Reliance, luckily, unlucky or luckily, they had so much of mishandling that at one time they were, I mean, we were out of the 50 lakhs which we have recovered through the insurance lakhs is from Reliance Life. So why they did it? Because there was some pressure on Reliance Life in last 1-2 years to solve this big time mis-selling which they did through AB Capital, you know, their own corporate agent who, you had an AB Capital case?
Somebody, I still get those phone calls from
there. No, but that, what policy was AB Capital?
That I don't know.
That you don't know.
Because he's the agent who, that name never appears anywhere.
No, the agent name is there, no, it's there. And the broker name, agent name, code has to be there.
Delhi based.
So at one point, that's what I said, we recovered 35 lakhs, but in many cases, if the person, same person directly going to the company, they were not entertaining as much as we routing it. But still there was some pressure from IIDA to solve, and you were lucky that they in that period they were helping the consumers. But maybe that period is over because we are not sure if they are still continuing that mode of helping, you know. Where what I'm trying to say is that there was some specific period which they were little bit more proactive to solve the complaints and helping out. But I'm not sure if they're still in that same mode of, you know, the pressure from IID is no longer there, then, you know, that whole thing is gone.
Can't there be something for mis-selling? The person who is mis-selling, he is also fixed. It's like, it's like you have a product and it is not suitable for that 60-year-old guy. Somebody is selling. You will give his money back, but what about that person mis-selling to another person?
We had a cover story of a person for whom we recovered 12 lakhs for this mis-selling, Reliance Life, and this was even before the AB Capital episode. But that 12 lakhs was a, you know, train ticket collector. He had put all his retirement funds into Reliance Life, you know, a lot of forged signatures, you know, any personal data was incorrect, everything. But it had to, you know, there's nothing done to, I mean, it was sold by Reliance Life, not just an agent, but a proper office, Kulaba office. You know, proper manager is there, everybody is there, and it's nothing happened to them. I mean, they come in, you would think that they would take action, but I mean, we just leave it that we got the money for him, and you know, that's the end of it. So, this is the last slide, issues to or lack of will, lack of proper guidance, regulatory support in some cases can be good, some pressure is there, then it works. Cost of litigation in some cases for consumer court, litigation time. So, this, yeah.
Ombudsman's verdict is binding on the company.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. But for instance, if a person goes to a consumer court,
he can go. Yeah.
Yeah, but then if the verdict is not favorable to the company, they can go into appeal in a consumer court.
Yeah, consumer court. That is the thing. That is where ombudsman is the best option to begin with, right? Because it's free of cost. It's the award is binding to the insurance company. But if the award is against the insured, the insured can go to consumer court. So it's not binding on the insured. The policyholder can go to consumer court, but then you're right, if it goes to the consumer court, it can go to different levels also, and company can appeal. Yeah.
My question is that, are the online terms from the website directly, are they also alerted to some agent directly by the company or
no? Some companies have HDFC Life, I think they allow through agent by giving some commission of 3% or so to the agent. So the premium might be 3% higher if you go through agent.
Okay, because when we take the offline policy, we know the person from which mm-hmm. Whom we are mm-hmm. buying, mm-hmm. right? So that in case of unforeseen event, we can catch hold of the person and he can help us in sorting out the claim.
Right.
But in case of online term policy, if the agent is directly alerted by the company, so can we know the points and can we know the documentation parts which will be required to submit when you are not there?
Yeah, I mean, the documentation is pretty, I mean, standard. I think, you know, whatever is death certificate and this and that, or claims form has to be submitted, or if there is any, you know, accidental death, then there has to be what you call FIR filed, or, you know, post-mortem report. If it's a non-accidental, then it's pretty, you know.
So can we get that confirmation directly from the company?
What all documentation is required?
Yeah, required.
Yeah, it's pretty, I think, transparent. Insurance company will have saying what are the documentation required for submitting the death claim. Yeah, it's there. You can get it from the website. And like I said, some companies like HDFC Life, you can buy through agent by paying that little bit 3%, 3.5% higher premium, because that is a commission they have set for the agent, for which is not substantial, but is okay. I mean, 3%. If you feel it is worth buying through agent, then 3% is not much. I mean, if you, because, but only, yeah.
What happens to the ATC benefit if we surrender the policy?
2 years minimum you have to pay. 2 years. I mean, that is.
If you surrender midway?
Yeah, if you pay only one premium, then ATC has to be reversed.
Reversed, right?
And but two premiums you pay, you're okay. Again, there is some people, tax experts, who will say that 2 years for traditional and 5 years for ULIP. So they will try to say that if you don't pay for 5 years for ULIP, then you have to reverse ATC for all the last 5 years or 4 years. I don't think that's true. I mean, according to us, if you see the ATC wordings, that 5 years, it is pointing to ULIP sold by UTI and LIC mutual fund. So it's clearly mentioning that it's pointing to clause 10, clause 11. That clause 10, clause 11 says that they are referring to ULIP only as ULIP purchased through UTI, which was started in 1971, and ULIP, which is actually a mutual fund having some insurance component, something like that, purchased through LIC mutual fund, not LIC. So what we feel is that, I mean, it has to be only 2 years for ATC. If you are paid 2 years, you should be okay. I mean, even though some people are saying ULIP should be paid for 5 years, I mean, I will be surprised if somebody is paid for 4 years and then going back and changing their tax document for it, reversing the ATC or not. It's very unlikely. But 2 years, yes, you have to pay. If you pay only for 1 year, unless it is single premium, then it's okay. But if it is regular premium, 2 years minimum. And then 3 years, you anyway pay for the surrender value, which is, you know, okay. So you should be okay with 3 years, according to me. Any other questions or anything? I'm here for.
Yeah, go ahead. So while taking the online term plan, the company decides on the income part.
Yeah.
If you are having a specific income, then only you are aware of the specific term plan.
Yeah.
Right. But if the insurance wants to take a term plan for a specific amount, say, so 50 lakhs or so, and if he currently is not capable of that, the income part is not. But in future, it's going to get increased, right?
Then you
so
can buy in future, but they won't give more than 10 times to 20 times. I mean, that is the usual range. 10 times your annual salary. Some might only give 10 times, some might give up to 20 times, you know, your salary. So your salary is 5 lakhs. Some might only restrict you to 50 lakhs. Some might give up to 1 crore for 5 lakh salary. But for 5 lakh salary, if you are asking for 2 crores, nobody is going to give. Because then it becomes that case of fraud also possible, where somebody is trying to over-insure themselves for fraud reason, you know, because there are cases where people, I mean, you'll be surprised. I mean, I will talk in favor of insurance company that there are cases where in some smaller cities, they will buy insurance after the person is dead and make all this, you know, build, fudge all these death certificates and all to show as if the person died after buying the policy. So somebody is wanting to do a fraud. They will try to buy that 2 crore policy and the person is already dead, and they will make up some death certificate of future dates, and after 2 years they will say, hey, the person died after 2 years. They will pay two premiums. Okay, two premiums they paid 10,000 each, but they are looking at paying 20,000 premium and getting 2 crores back. That's the fraud they are looking at. So it's a trick they are playing by, you know. So
can we increase the this in the term that policy amount?
No, buy another policy.
You have to buy another.
Buy another policy. You can't change anything. Once it is done, that's the term, that's the premium. That's it. Or you have policies some which have like increased sum assured. They increase the sum assured every year or every 5 years.
Sir, what you just now talked, that increasing the sum assured, I have just studied that increasing the sum assured 5% every year, 10% every year.
Yeah.
But substantially, they are increasing that annual premium also.
Premium.
A premium is not commensurate with the increase.
Premium will not increase. Premium will be fixed for every year, but that amount will be little bit.
Much higher, sir. If you ask 5% every year increase, that your premium is higher by about 60% than the.
That's why we say the fixed term. That's why we say 10% buying a term plan.
130%, sir.
Buy a term plan just for a specific sum assured without worrying about increase it or decrease. Yeah. There are two different ways also looking at some have decrease also. But just buy for the exact sum assured what you want, and without worrying about the riders also which come with it, just the pure term plan without worrying they are offering critical illness rider or not, accidental death or not, that you can buy separately. You know, a personal accident policy you can buy don't worry about all the riders or just pure term plan, whatever you want for the sum assured premium. You very transparent. You know the premium, what you will pay for 25 years, 30 years. That is the same amount you pay, and you know, you buy for a specific sum assured. And if you feel in future there is a more need, you are earning more, family is there, you want more, you buy another policy. No, you just declare that you have an existing policy. So
that's a compulsion.
So because then again, they don't want to over-insure, right? If you have 10 other policies and you're buying an 11th one, they will say, why are you having a 10 different, you know, so many policies of, so, I mean, again, it's the whole concept of, are you over-insuring?
Okay.
If you're trying to over-insure, nobody wants you to insure, because over-insuring is strictly considered as something to do with fraud.
Right. So this case is for my son who has taken this traditional policy from HDFC Life, and that time it is all insurance people are basically the known people, friends, circle, all these things influence basically. And during those period we thought that it's okay. Now it is 30 years plan, and we don't think it is a viable purpose, and it is useful also. I am thinking of it.
So three premiums have been paid.
Yeah, already paid.
Four premiums. Yeah, you can surrender, but you have to ask for that special surrender value and non-guaranteed special surrender value and see what is the...
But I asked the insurance company, they are saying that you have to continue.
No, not like that. I mean, the traditional policy, you paid three premiums, you give them in writing in your letter that you want to surrender, but you want to know what is the special surrender value you're going to offer. Get them to stamp your application and they will have to give you offer. They'll have to give you, but then don't surrender blindly, because the surrender value may be very less. You ask, they will give the guaranteed surrender value, but if it is very less, it's worthless, right? So you may ask for the non-guaranteed special surrender value, and if that is decent enough, then...
Can we not ask both for the same
time? So guaranteed, you can calculate, it's there in the policy document, it's pretty straight calculation. Non-guaranteed is the one which you don't ask for. Guaranteed, you know, but you don't want to rely on guaranteed because it is very low, so you wouldn't want to know what is the non-guaranteed special value which they can give, and then make a decision. Thank you. Welcome. Thanks. Thank you.